Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Private Property Farming Podcast. My name is Mbali Nwoko, once again, your host every Tuesdays and Thursdays on the Private Property Farming Podcast. Thank you for choosing us this evening and for constantly following the Farming Podcast. We see your tweets, we see your retweets, we see your Instagram likes, your Insta story shares. And it's been so fantastic engaging with you on social media and also just to hear feedback from all the viewers at home, just telling us about how great the podcast is and the information that you're learning around farming, agribusiness, and all good things to do with agriculture. Today we have a hydroponic and greenhouse expert, and we're going to be speaking about agricultural sustainability developments. What does sustainability mean in farming? How can farmers really grow their farms using sustainability in their production methods, but also making a profit, because everybody wants to make a profit when you invest in a business such as farming. And so today we have none other than Johan van den Bosch, who is a hydroponic and greenhouse expert. And we're going to be unpacking sustainability, hydroponics, as well as greenhouse farming, all under the umbrella of agricultural sustainability developments. Johan, thank you so much for joining us. How are you doing?
Thank you, Mbali. Thanks for inviting me to this. I'm good.
That's good. It's great to see you once again. So, Johan, I know you a bit and a bit about your background, but for those at home who have never met you and have never heard about Johan, please just maybe tell us who you are and give us a brief background on your experience in the agricultural sector.
Yeah, thank you, Mbadin. I was a youngster when I started to farm. I was 22 years old, and I had a vision and started farming in tunnels in the ground. Mm-hmm. And we had a vision and saying, okay, we wanted to be expert in what we're doing. And we're starting to planting the fancy lettuce, specialized lettuce, and starting to supplying Woolworths and the other retails like Pick n Pay and Spar and Freshmark. And and then we decide to, in our journey of 10 years, we decide to starting to growing an hydroponic and seeing if we can bring in the growing time of the product quicker, putting more crop on per square meter, and see in what way we can be more sustainable to supply retail. So we started to the NFT system where we're planting lettuce in gutters, where we literally score a week of growth, so a week quicker on hydroponics versus ground growth. And then obviously undercover protection, and a retail like Woolworths always liked it because they show about a product on the shelf. And I don't have an issue with nature, what is, I think, believe the farmer's biggest enemy currently, where global warming is a reality, where we literally protect and make sure we can growing quicker, a better product, and we are sustainable there, and nature are not attacked us. Yes, you have always nature, it can be a issue, but you minimize your nature effect on your farm. And I must say, over the years, over 20 years of experience and growing, I believe that you have to take nature out of it. And it's coming obviously with a price, and we learn a lot. It's not easy to change your farming operation from ground to hydroponics. But the moment if you get it right and you have the basics right and you have your market right and you can get every day on the market, so the sustainability side, yes, then I think that is the way to go.
Yeah. Johan, I'm curious to know when we all know that there's things like climate change and, with that, these new terms like sustainability, intensive farming, organic farming has obviously come into the fore when agriculture is concerned. But is hydroponic farming the best solution, to meet sustainability goals? Can a farmer still be sustainable if they are producing directly onto the soil, or do they need to farm hydroponically?
Okay, I think the first thing what we have to realize and we have to make sure about is that not every crop you can grow hydroponically. Okay, I think that's the thing what we have to make sure on. So don't come in and saying you want to plant a carrot or a potato in hydroponics. I mean, it's not going to work. But if you're going to your tomatoes, peppers, jalapenos, that kind of crops, yes. I think if the moment if you can measure what you add and what is in your environment, the better you have a maximum production out of your plant. The moment if you're planting in ground and you don't know what is the ground doing, because a ground culture is acting the way you want to act, and you can't control it as a farmer, so you will never getting the maximum out of your plant. The hydroponic side of farming is monocropping, where if you're going in soil, you have to do crop rotation. Now, I mean, crop rotation and crop rotation is a big thing. You can't say on ground grow that you're growing tomatoes and you're going, for argument's sakes, you're growing a lettuce and thinking you're doing crop rotation. It's not going to work. You have to giving that time, like a 5-6 year time before you're coming back with tomatoes. Yes, you can planting tomatoes after tomatoes after tomatoes, but somewhere along the line, in the 5-6-7-8 year time, you will getting you will start to eat problems in your soil. And you're getting weaker soil, your soil is not strong enough, you don't have production, you get pest and fungus in your production, you didn't getting your kilos off, and then you not be sustainable. It's all about getting the maximum per square meter, and in hydroponics, you can do that because you add exactly the amount of fertilizer, exactly the amount of water, what that specific plant needed. And then you can get running a top and make sure you're getting your yield off per square meter. And I think there's where hydroponics coming in. But you have to make sure there's different hydroponics for different crops. There's different crops, but you can't planting in hydroponics. And that is, I think, the two things that you have to make sure on.
Right. You mentioned that you farmed on NFT hydro systems, and that's one form of hydroponic farming. And then we all know that there's also the hydroponic farming in growing bags, you know, using sawdust, using cocoa peats. And typically, or generally what we typically see in South Africa is that farmers growing in bags are growing in greenhouses, etc. So it's a lot of investment. Yes, we want to be sustainable. We want to maximize the yield per square meter. But what do you say to farmers who say, Johan, but I've been farming in bags, whether it's sawdust or cocoa peats, year after year. I'm trying to maximize my square meter as possible in my tunnel. But costs are going up. You know, 1 year, the cocoa peat or the sawdust costs X. The following year, it costs Y. But you know, my tomato prices at the end of the day are still the same. So like, how do farmers manage this battle, but at the same time trying to be sustainable and efficient and also just maybe make a profit at the end of the day?
Okay, I think there's a couple of answers here. Okay. The first of all is, are you big enough? In that way, there's an economical scale in each and every crop. So the moment if you don't supply in any months of the year, you have a challenge. So you have to supply each and every month. And while you're going to get it right, if you scale. And it's all about the economical scale. If you, and I'm telling you now, I'm see it every day, and I see it in my own farm, you're not going to make money in a 5,000 square meter greenhouse. You're not going to make money. Yes, you're going to make money, but your overheads is going to labor to pay. You still so that things are still running. So you can't stop Eskom and say, all right, I don't want to paying electricity. It's not working like that. So the one thing is scale. The second thing is nature again. So if you can control nature in that specific greenhouse, then your chance for sustainability is more than without, because the market the big farmers on, let's say, tomatoes getting, let's say, 8.5 kilos per plant. If you're getting 6.5 kilos per plant, meaning you're not doing anything right, because you have to go to 8.5 kilos per plant. So that is that the yield per square meter is so important in a greenhouse environment, because you're paying per square meter to put that thing up. So yes, you have to get an income per square meter to paying for that infrastructure. Where if you're going outland and then planting outside, but that costs you nothing. So if you have to throwing away a bit of outside land, no, nobody is going to bother. But in an infrastructure, greenhouse, hydroponic, you can't throw anything away. You have to running the maximum yield out of it.
You mentioned scale, and you said 5,000 square meters greenhouse, you're not going anywhere. So what is the solution? At how many greenhouses or how many square meters does one maybe reach an equilibrium or a break even? Or let's say there could be a farming podcast listener who is thinking, I want to make investments in greenhouses, maybe to farm tomatoes, cucumbers, or peppers, for example. How many tunnels maybe should I need to start off with? If he or she is listening to you right now and heard 5,000 square meters is not much. So how many plus minus tunnels does one need to start off with, especially when the target is to meet the yield per square meter?
Okay, it is also depends on what crop you're growing.
Yes.
If I going back to my operation, I didn't grow, or I didn't start with tunnels of 20 tunnels.
Yes.
I'm starting with a 5 tunnel operation, and I growing to a certain point. Okay, so you must all I always saying to the guys, please don't starting with an hectare of 2 hectares operation, because you have to getting in that operation. You have to doing the management. You have to make sure things are running. You have to make sure your crop has been marketable. Is there's a market for it? There's a client for it. So I always saying starting with a 5,000 square meter, but my end goal is a 6 hectare. And you putting every year another 5,000 of another hectare up, depends on how quick you're growing. So that is very important, that you're going to understand that your first year of your first 2 years, you're going to burn money. And you have to make sure you have a source of money to pulling you through, to make sure that the money you make out of the greenhouse, you invest back and starting to growing the business. Then you're growing the business as infrastructure, but you're also growing your management to a certain point. So and that is what I would try to say, is that that yes, there is obviously like tomatoes. I'm telling you now, from 1-2 hectares, you're starting to make money, because now you've been 52 weeks a year in production, because you schedule your plantings. So and then on that size, you can schedule your planting. But it all depends what is your market. Obviously, with currently tomato prices, and I mean the tomato prices was high from January. Yes, obviously that reach of scale is going to be quick. But I mean, what is going to happen next year, we don't know. What's going to happen the year after that, we don't know. So it all depends on what is your market, what is the maximum price you can get it out of it, and then see how quick you can getting it up to scale. I mean, I started with 5 tunnels, I ending up with 136 tunnels. But it's coming over a period of 10 years. It's not coming in the first year. And that is how you have to see that.
Yeah. Speaking about markets and speaking about revenues, when one is making an investment in a greenhouse, in hydroponic structures, what should come first? You know, so let's say I had, for example, 10 million right now to invest in greenhouse and put hydroponics. Before I invest into that, what should come first? Do I go speak to the market and figure out what does the market want? And then also maybe do I go speak to maybe an agronomist or an expert like yourself to help me to say, if you've got this 10 million, for example, make an investment of X amount of tunnels, because this can obviously generate revenue, and then from there you grow. So do we start with the market? Do we start with the expertise? Or do we go straight and investing in the infrastructure, and then you come back to the market and agronomy or technical expertise like you have shown or displayed this evening?
I think that the big thing is first crop, what you wanted to grow. Then according to the crop, the infrastructure. Because if you have in your blood you wanted to plant carrots, you don't need the infrastructure. Only infrastructure you want is a pivot, maybe. Okay. Beetroot, cabbage, that kind of thing. But if you wanted to decide to plant lettuce, obviously you're going to look to a gutter system. No need to plant it in bags, because you wanted to get a maximum per square meter. So first is what you wanted to grow. Obviously, you're going to do a bit of market research and seeing what is needed in your community, maybe you in Limpopo, far north of somewhere in Mpumalanga, far that side, and see what is your community needed and what is your transport cost going to Joburg market, because obviously Gauteng is not the off-take. But obviously you must also see what climate you have. So there's no need for you to thinking you're growing to put you growing argument sakes close in Limpopo, or let's say close to Polokwane, and you're going to putting a greenhouse up there for tomatoes, where ZZ2 can do it open lands. So now you have to compete with ZZ2. And your infrastructure, so your kilo price to grow tomatoes is going to be higher than going to be at ZZ2. So you will be always out of the market. So it is, depends on crop, infrastructure, and climate. I mean, I going to a place in Heidelberg, for argument's sakes, and they wanted to, there's a mice grower, and he wanted to invest in veggies. And the first thing what I was telling to them, I want the temperature logger on your farm, and I wanted to see what is your minimum temperature and what is your maximum temperature. When I saw his minimum temperature turning at minus 16, I just telling him, don't invest in a veggie tunnel, because your energy cost to heat that tunnel in winter, you're going to be outpriced yourself. So I always saying, what is the climate in your area to make a decision what crop to grow, to make a decision what infrastructure you need. And if you get that right, then you are sustainable.
Then you're sustainable.
So what is Ryan Heidelberg going to do? He's going to plant pecanut. He's not going to doing. So we convince him to say, but what planting pecanuts or apples or cherries, because the cold units is good enough for that. So now he's not going to put any infrastructure up. He's going to put in infrastructure up of his trees, but not on his, not on a, on a, on a greenhouse or something like that. And that is what we have to look of. We that's very important. And anyone who's listening to us, please make sure what climate. Don't challenge climate. Don't challenge nature. You're not going to get it right.
Absolutely. And so for the farmers that are maybe listening, who are based in KZN, Northwest, and let's say maybe Limpopo, you know, some of the warmer regions where we're like, oh, so let me take KZN out. Okay, let's talk about the warmer region areas, right? Because there are areas where it gets extremely hot, take Limpopo, for example, and, you know, infrastructure like greenhouses, sometimes it's not necessary. So for the farmers who are listening and thinking, I'm in a very hot climate, my temperature during winter and summer is still hot as compared to Johannesburg or the Highveld region. And they're hearing us talking about hydroponic farming and greenhouses. And if they are in those regions, how can they now farm sustainably? You know, do they invest in shade net structures, or maybe just do they just farm an open crop that is best for their climate? But, you know, they could be hearing sustainability and thinking sustainability means hydroponic. So I think the question that I'm trying to ask is, for farmers in warmer areas, how can they practice sustainability if they are doing open field farming and not necessarily hydroponic or greenhouse farming?
Yeah, that is very difficult, to be honest, because you still can't control your temperatures, and you still can't control your weather. So obviously we don't like rain on our crops. We don't like wind on our crops. So there is ways that you can using a shade net structure and cover for that. But obviously a shade net structure is not climate control. So you have to dealing a bit with that climate. But there is certain area in South Africa where it's literally not worth it to plant any veggies. So then you have to look into something else, like a avo or a mango or a macadamia nuts or that kind of thing. So again, I think there's a lot of farmers try to challenge weather and saying, okay, weather is a problem here. We're going to putting an infrastructure up. It's cost us 1,000 rand a square meter to put an infrastructure up. But I never realized that 100 kilometers further, that guy is doing it in the open land, and his cost per product is. So it's very difficult. And that is what I'm still trying to say, is that we have to make sure that we plant the right crops in the right climate. and not try to because the logistic in South Africa is all over everywhere. So, I mean, I started to supply Woolworths in my early days, 20 years ago, and we're supplying Woolworths right through the year, from summer through winter. There was never a problem because the climate allowed us. Now Woolworths is getting clever, and it's not because they are clever, they are clever, is that they're saying, but you know what? We're not going to getting the high-field lettuce in winter because the quality is not right. Let's moving the production to the middle field or to the low field, and we're getting a good product on the shelf. So they realize also they have to move around. So what are you as farmer going to do to make sure in winter production you can do something else? A soup, greens, or what a case, to make sure that you can have an income in that. So that's what I'm, again, climate, you can't challenge climate. Yes, in a greenhouse, you can challenge climate, but you must make sure that you're not putting a greenhouse somewhere up where the price not going to paying back that infrastructure cost. And yeah, that is very important to see that.
Yeah, as I'm listening to Johan, I'm getting a bit nervous because I'm just thinking about my farm. And I know that, you know, around mid-May the mid-May or the third week of May onwards, you know, that's where frost starts to kick in. And then June, July, it gets quite cold, as well as August. And we really don't produce during that time because it's just so cold, you can't produce anything. So now I'm thinking, I know that in those months we don't generate any revenue. Now I'm probably thinking I need to explore what type of crop can grow in that period. But you mentioned about markets and the retailer. Coming back to sustainability, you know, when a person is investing in a farm, investing in structures, having considered the climate, the markets, the landscape, the logistics, just where they are, would you say for farmers, when you're farming in greenhouse and hydroponic structures, the best rand value for your crop, would you get it from retail, or would you get it from processors, or would you get it from the fresh produce markets, or would you get it from exports markets? So under these classifications, where should a farmer focus on in terms of market once they start farming under greenhouse hydroponically?
I'm going to say something, and I think a lot of people don't going to like it, but that is the reality. I was a contract farmer my whole life. And to be honest, to be a contract farmer, you don't have a business. So that meaning, if you're supplying on a contract, and the shape must be that big and that high and that weight and what a guy is, you don't, they're going to dictate you. The best way to farm currently is to farm for yourself, for your own brand. So you're starting to develop your own brand. The other thing is, and that's a reality, I don't think South Africa uptake on produce is big enough with the economical situation in the country. So the export, you have to look to an export market. And the export market you can only do if you are on scale, and you can supply 52 weeks a year. And that export market is really a big market. I'm busy with a couple of countries where I try to getting offtakes, and I'm telling you, the opportunity to export is a lot. You must just open the doors. But inland, South Africa as a country, I think it's going to be taking another 5 years before we have the COVID situation under control, and the economic is growing again, and then the prices is going to be getting better, and there's again a buying power. Currently, we don't have a buying power. So you have to be very smart to make sure, yes, it's nice to have a contract with a retailer or with a processor, but they're dictating you. They're saying they want 500 kilos. If there's no orders, they're not taking your 500 kilos, or they're taking your 500 kilos and they reject it because of a silly reason, and you always bleeding on that. So thinking about your own market and your own brand. But you must understand, you can't have a brand first and then product. You need first product and then a brand. And if you can get that right, you're well away. And I can giving you a lot of samples in South Africa about getting it right.
When you're saying a brand, you know, for people that maybe might just not understand, it's a product then a brand. So meaning the product must be known by customers and be consistent, and then you become a household name. So if people would say, I want Johan peppers, for example, I want Mbali lettuce. So it's about selling the lettuce unknown. Just people just say, I like this specific lettuce grown by this farmer. And then as you keep consistent, people will then know that, this is Mbali lettuce, this is Johan lettuce. Is that correct?
Yes, and it doesn't matter you're supplying retail of the fresh produce market. It is all about you have to be there 365 days a year. I'm not saying with the same amount of product, but still every day you'll be on that market, and the market and the customers knowing exactly. Mbali is sending letters. That is the quality throughout the year. That is the price. And then you will see slowly but surely your brand is starting to grow.
Oh, thank you so much, Johan, for such an insightful conversation this evening. I wish we had much more time to discuss, around this topic. I've definitely learned a lot, and I must say you've made me quite nervous, because now it's like I must go back to the drawing board with my form and just make sure that did I tick all the checklist, in everything that you've said. But before I let you go, Johan, I just want to know, what's the one piece of advice would you give to farmers? Let's say those that are already in production. Now that we're in a new season, we're going towards the end of the year, and people want to make a quick buck because December's around the corner. What advice would you give to farmers right now who are currently in production, maybe ending a specific cycle and putting in a new crop, or just starting a new crop because it's a brand new season? So what advice would you give to farmers currently that are in production?
Yeah, obviously nature is always a challenge, but make sure your quality is there. Don't dump second grade, third grade on a market. So make sure your quality is right, and make sure you be every day there, and not once a week or once a month. And if you can get that right, that a market agent can trust you, that a customer at the market agent can trust your product, then you well away. And there's a future for farmers.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Johan. Thank you for your advice and your expertise this evening. And it was lovely having you onto the show.
No, it was a great pleasure. I really enjoy it. Thanks a lot.
Likewise. Thank you so much for watching, everybody at home. That was Johan van den Bosch, who's a hydroponic and greenhouse expert. And he told us about different markets that you could explore, what sustainability means and how you could address it, whether you're farming in a monocrop or doing crop rotation. He also gave us some gems about the minimum square meters or greenhouses that you would need to use when you want to farm a specific crop, let's say cucumbers, tomatoes, or peppers, and how much of that infrastructure you would need to firstly make a profit. And also, it's all about climate, working with climate, because if you're trying to beat the weather, you will never, never win. And so if you missed this conversation this evening, please go on to the Private Property YouTube channel, click on the Farming Podcast playlist, and you'll find episode 95 with Johan van den Bosch, Agricultural Sustainability Developments. That's the theme for tonight. And you can watch our conversation, which was about 30 minutes long. And please feel free to drop comments. We are willing to obviously respond to any burning questions that you have based on what we discussed tonight. However, that's it for me. It's been, in my areas, raining. So I hope, the farmers in various areas are happy that we're receiving rain. But yeah, thank you so much for watching, and continue to support the podcast. Like, share, comment, retweet, reshare, do whatever, and spread the word around the Farming Podcast as far as possible, because our intention here is to grow the agri-industry and to educate you, the aspirant farmer or the person wanting to go into the agriculture industry, about what awaits when you come into the sector. So that's it for me. That's it from myself and Johan. And we will see you next week, Tuesday, at 8 p.m. with another awesome guest. Take care.